love Ellen and her accompaniment, but to let us, Lord, hear our voices this morning in worship. That we are grateful and we are humbled and we are accepting of everything that this relationship is doing brings to us. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Vet. My sister, thank you so much. I'm looking forward to this. We have been in discussion about doing some new things with praise and worship, a little different, maybe during this time of Lent, and doing some co-leading, some sharing of this praise and worship time. So I hope that you embrace that with your minds, your bodies, your hearts, your spirits, and praise with us. And we're going to begin that time of praise now with singing, as we just did with Vet. But now, along with Matt Mayer, the artist who made All the People Said Amen.
One, two, three.
Continue our time of singing with How Sweet the Sound, this one by Citizen Way.
Yeah, though I walk through the valley, I know that you are always right beside me, and I will fear no evil. You're my rock and my strength, you comfort me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, I hear you singing over me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, and it's beautiful. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. covers every part of me. My soul is solid, I am found, and it's a beautiful sound. It's a beautiful, beautiful sound. Carry me through the waters where your peace clears away all my sorrow. Nothing can separate us from your life. Oh, your love, it will always be. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Every part of me, my soul is solid, I am found, and it's a beautiful sound. It's a beautiful, beautiful sound. You were healing in the pain, you were shelter in the storm.
Morning, y'all. So lately, with my new introduction to Lent, because I come from a non-denominational tradition, you know, storefront churches here and there. So Lent and all of this, we celebrated Easter, but Lent, this whole idea of 40 days of sacrifice and barrenness and contemplation and all of that is new to me. So that led me to look, I don't know why, but I was looking at the life of Christ, right? And I noticed that everybody that came to Christ came in need, primarily. There are over 30, and I got to be careful with Google, but there's 30 plus incidences where the widow, Jairus' daughter, the woman with the issue of blood, the demoniacs, the blind, the spittle, when Christ created spit and healed the man's sight. All of these instances where we as worshipers, we as human beings are seeking God, and we're seeking God in need. And I ask myself, why do you go to worship? Why do you go to church? And it dawned on me that it's not always because I'm in need. Sometimes I come to worship. Sometimes I come to rejoice, because of the goodness I'm experiencing in my life, in my relationships, right? And so during this Lenten season, I was thinking, all year long, we come in need. Not all the time, but how many of us come because we feel as though we need to? Right? And there's nothing wrong with that. But the emphasis of what I got out of my little study was this. Sometimes we need to come as the sinner. Not because we need something healed in our bodies, but because innately we are broken. And I looked at a woman like myself, a sinful woman, Luke 7. I'm not going to read it all, but it's the situation where the sinner approaches Christ in someone else's home. Verse 8, she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and to dry them with her hair. When she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment, she came with sacrifice. Isn't that what Lent is about? Right? Is it? You can talk to me. I don't know. I don't know everything. I just started. I'm new. But that was my point. How I wish I could walk. So if I come because I'm hurting, if I come because I'm human, if I come because I'm sick, if I come because I lost someone that I love, if I come because something is broken, when is it that we come and we break the alabaster box? When do we come and weep at his feet in worship? Not because of our need, but because of who he is. How many of us would really take our hair, I couldn't, but, and wipe the feet with our tears? In these next 40 days, I want to be one that comes to worship, to sacrifice. Not just because I have a need. So let's consider in the next 40 days breaking our alabaster boxes and giving back to God because God is so deserving. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Vet. Lord, I need you.
I confess bowing here I find my rest. Without you I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holy dead is Christ in me. cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Oh God, how I need you.
Amen. It's come to that time in our worship where you want to get your paper and your pen or pencil out so that you can jot down all of the ministry and worship opportunities that we have going on at Grace this coming week.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. A good snowy morning, I guess. Did everyone have an okay time getting here this morning? Did you have a good morning, Bet?
I did.
You did? You slid around? It was a little crazy at the Nash house this morning, just a little bit. We have a sick dog at the house. Not a person who's sick as a dog, but an actual sick dog. And if you see Andrew, give him a little hug because it happened in his room, so... And, you know, you keep telling your kids, you know, don't leave clothes on the floor, don't leave clothes on the floor. I don't think he'll ever leave clothes on the floor again. So that's what our morning was like. So I know you're probably like, Brandy, just get to the announcement. So I'll have Vet kick it off.
Okay, IFSS, need you please consider helping this cause. We need Saturday day sitters, two shifts, one overnight, and one meal. This rotation is March 8th through the 15th. Any questions, you know who to contact. If you don't, it's Glenda. And Glenda is right there.
And I hope you all join us today after worship. We'll have a potluck and a special church conference to approve the permanent endowment fund. So please join us.
All right, fellowship donations. So the coffee and the kitchen supplies that we use, creamer and sugar, you know, things like that, we need some money for that. So if you could please see Luann, that would be fantastic to donate and keep the coffee flowing. Coffee is very important in the Methodist life.
This morning at the Komea shelter, 50 people were fed. A special thanks to Dave Barry, Janet Mershner, and Randy Heiser for serving.
That's fantastic. That is fantastic. All right, Faith Day at the Rockies, July 26th, 2:10 p.m., Rockies versus the Reds. I feel like I'm a sports announcer. Michael W. Smith will be the entertainer. We need 25 tickets to get a group price of $24. We had an announcement from the peanut gallery over here. No. I love you, Wanda. All right, so yeah, Wanda, finish that up for us.
Okay, let's see here. The United Methodist Women of Grace United Methodist Church invite you to rally for women's rights March 8th, International Women's Day at 2 p.m. at the Cheyenne Capitol Steps, showing we support women's rights and the elimination of violence and abuse of women and children. Make it happen. Unite with us to show Wyoming we are the equality state for all, and let policymakers know violence and abuse are unacceptable. If you would like more information, just find Kathy Orr or Mary Lou Markham.
Okay, so the directory needs to be updated. So after service today in the Grace Hall, we need you to check, update, confirm your directory information. You know, last week I forgot one, so I'm gonna look through real quick.
All right, now it's time for birthdays and anniversaries this week. Okay, for birthdays, on the 25th, Bobby Markham. On the 26th, Lily Lacombe.
On the 27th, Caitlin Rodifer. And on the 29th, Mr. Leon Latham. Leap year. I thought that said that Bobby was going to be 25 this year. Where is Bob?
And for anniversaries, February 29th, Jason and Stephanie Leaf, 7 years. So if you have a birthday this week, the birthday cake will be making the rounds. Just raise your hand. And if you'd like to contribute to the cake, that would be great. The money helps support people in our community that need it. A lot of people like to contribute $1 for every year they've been born, been alive, and or $1 for every year they've been married. But it's really up to you how much you'd like to contribute. And with that, we'll continue on with our worship.
Good morning. Please stand and join me in today's unison invocation and then remain standing for the first hymn. We come before you, O God, in the shadow of the cross, grateful for your great love for us. As you came in Jesus to win our love and obedience, reveal yourself among us still. Give us courage to follow Jesus over rocky hills, where we carry our crosses and green valleys, where you restore our souls. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated, and I invite our children to come forward for children's time.
Tell me what your favorite food is. Cake. What's your favorite food? You can pick a couple. If it's just hard to narrow to just one. Pizza. That's a good one. Shrimp. That's a good one. Yeah? You like shrimp? Yeah? And cake. Pizza. Steak. That's another good one. Emery, what you got? There's so many. Yeah. Trying to think. Mine is popcorn. I love popcorn. It's one of my most favorite foods. Mexican food. Yes. Mexican. Candy. Candy is good. What happens if I said all week you just get to eat that? Just candy all week.
That would be awesome.
Some are like, that would be awesome. And some are like, bleh. If you eat it over and over and over again, it gets disgusting.
Like at Guadalajara.
Guadalajara.
Sunday, I used to get a
you get the same
chicken
thing.
Enchilada. I used to get that. I got sick of it.
Chicken enchiladas at Guadalajara all the time.
So
too much of a good thing.
So
now you have a chili relleno. I like chili rellenos too. Those are yummy. Yeah. Now I'm starting to get hungry. You like what? Plain chili? Just plain chili. Yeah, that's good too. Now I'm getting hungry. So there's a reason why you need to have a variety and you need to have a balance. So one of the things, because I have teenagers, and you know what teenagers really like to do? I don't even know if they're here to listen.
Sleep?
Yes, sleep. When they're little, I'd say take a nap, and they're like, meh, yeah. And I'd say, well, you don't have to sleep. Just go lay down for a few minutes. And then they'd be out, right? Now they're like, please let me go to bed. To wake them up in the morning. Wake up. It's Saturday. You should get out of bed. It's 10 a.m. No, I'm going to sleep somewhere. They love sleep. So there are different parts of your life where you really like something. And then like Emery said, if you get too much of it, then you're like, okay, that's no good. I don't want any more. Yeah, sometimes. Sometimes you really don't want to sleep. And now you're like, yes, I want all the sleep. Yeah, and what happens if you would do that all the time? Then it wouldn't be so good. How many of you like to play video games? Yeah,
not so much.
Not so much? That's all right. Yeah. So if you played video games all the time, do you think you get sick of it?
No. Yes. My eyes would probably sink into my brain.
It might sink into your brain. You wouldn't care if you only had that one game to play all the time. Do you finally like once you beat it, then it's like
one.
Oh, if you can have free play, if you can play all the different kinds of games, then it would be okay. So you need to find a balance in life. So John the Baptist in our scripture later today, he's wandering around, and guess what he gets to eat all the time? Not pizza.
His
no, he didn't eat bread. That was a good guess. Not apples. Grasshoppers. Grasshoppers. He lived on grasshoppers. And you know what else he got to eat?
What?
Honey.
Oh, honey.
No, in the Bible I was reading, maybe he dipped the grasshoppers in the honey and maybe that made them better. I should have brought some. You could have tried it. Do you think you would have tried it?
No.
No. Really? Maybe? Depends on how much honey. Then the honey's good. Guess what my bees are doing right now? You know I have bees? You know I have bees? No, they're not making honey. No. They're sleeping. What are they going to pollinate? Did you see outside? No. So my bees are... So you guys think of like days or weeks, right? My bees think of seasons. So this is the time when they sleep and they calm down and they stay warm. And then in the summertime, in the spring, yeah, they hibernate. And then in the spring, they come out and they are starving. And so they eat everything and they pollinate and they run all over. And there's a... And if you mess with them, they're like, hey. Actually, my bees aren't too aggressive. They don't really want to sting you.
They're awesome.
Honeybees, you know, if they sting you, they die. So they don't really want to sting you. They're not like wasps. They're mean, nasty little critters. I don't like them. John the Baptist should have been eating those wasps. No? No. Anyway, so they don't really want to. They're not very mean, but they're starving. So they think in seasons. And so now it's a season where they calm and they rest and they stay warm. So I don't see them much at all. So you need to think about how do you need to take care of yourself. I do have bees. I have a lot of bees. Yeah, they're cool. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, they're really cool. But so you need to think of, you know, when's it a time to, because I know that if somebody's going to put a whole bowl of popcorn in front of me, I think I want to eat the whole bowl of popcorn. And if somebody were to say, guess what, you get to sleep all the time to my teenagers, they'd probably say, yay. But really, you need to find a balance, and you need to think about what's important to you and how you need to balance that out. It's a season of Lent, and so now it's a time where we need to focus on that, and how do we need to sacrifice, and how do we need to. So there's a reason why there's some seasons in our lives. And I know that I get trapped in that, and I'm like, I need to work all the time. No, you need to take some time to play too. But if you play all the time, then that's not very good either. So you need to find that balance. So think about that as you go forward. And if somebody puts a whole pizza in front of you, eat it. and share with others. Because it might not be healthy for you to eat it all, whole pizza. Although I bet you probably could. Yeah, that would be delicious. All right, so think about seasons in your life and during the day and how to take care of yourself like my bees do. All right, you may go sit down. Thank you.
Today's Old Testament reading comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 15, verses 20 and 21. Then the prophet Miriam, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand, and all the women went out after her with tambourines and with dancing. And Miriam sang to them, "Sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and rider he has thrown into the sea." The word of God for the people of God.
As we enter into our time of prayer, as we've just entered a new season, of course, you can expect a little something different in our worship order. So I just kind of want to walk through that with you so you'll be prepared as the time comes. After our prayers of the community, we will share together in a unison prayer, and then I'll invite you into some moments of your own private prayer and reflection. After some moments of that private prayer, you'll hear music, we'll call it our musical prayer, some music starting to be played, and then you'll hear some words starting to be sung around you. That's kind of your signal maybe to open your eyes and to look at the words on the screen. And as we sing through that sung prayer, we'll sing through it several times. You can join in as you feel comfortable. And then we'll pray the Lord's Prayer. So as we come to this prayer time, we know that we have several joys and concerns in front of us. I don't know if anybody had a prayer card that I didn't get, but if you do, raise it up and Dan will get it up to me. As many of you know, this past week on Tuesday, Shirley Hitchcock, whom we've been praying for a long time, passed away. And we were able to celebrate her life here in the sanctuary on Friday afternoon. It was a celebration. We ran out of bulletins and chairs. So you know that this was a special lady, remembered and celebrated by many. Also, we have a prayer request from Catherine Herbaugh. Her friend Diana Mayers and her family, we're asking for prayers for them. Diana has cancer again, and there's a possibility that it has gone to her brain. There are more tests coming. Also, we ask you to be in prayer for a kind of a sister congregation of ours down in Wellington, Colorado, not too far south. There is a small United Methodist Fellowship. They're not a chartered church, but a small group of, 15 to 25 people that gather each Sunday. And I ask for prayers for Reverend Deb Olenek, our district superintendent, who is also here today, and Skip Strickland, who's the DS in the Colorado side. As this congregation or this fellowship has decided to sell their building and they're in some transition around some leadership for that fellowship. So I ask you to pray for our DSs, for me, for Leah, and for Vet, our interns, who have been asked to help kind of assess some of their needs that they might have during this transition time until they decide what they're going to be doing. So I ask you to be in prayer with the Wellington United Methodist Fellowship. And also, as I kind of indicated, we have a joy that Deb Olenek, our district superintendent for all of Wyoming, if you ever think you have to drive a lot for your job, try to be the district superintendent of all of Wyoming, is here to celebrate with worship with us and to be with us for our church conference after worship to establish our endowment. So we're glad you're here. Will you join with me in our unison prayer of confession? Reconciling God, compassionate Christ, we realize that our hearts tend to wander. On the path of life that you set before us, we often go astray by following scents that are more enticing or scenes that are more to our liking. Before we even know it, we are wandering aimlessly, with no clear trail beneath our feet and no light to guide our way. We admit that we need your voice calling our names so that we can have a direction to embrace again. Guide us, lead us, show us. Amen. I invite you now into a few moments of your own private prayer and reflection. Holy and gracious and loving God, we come to you asking that you take us as we are. We know that we gather in this place from so many different places, from our homes, from our jobs, from our lives, from our families, from our solitude, from our joy, from our grief, and everything in between. Holy God, as we come to this place, we ask that you take us as we are. Because there are so many things that we attend to in our lives, we just can't put on a facade or shine ourselves up too much as we come here. We need some grace. We need your open arms. Because sometimes we can't always hold it together. Sometimes we can't always come with all of our to-do tasks done. Sometimes we just need you to take us as we are. And for some of us, that means that we're doing okay. And we're glad that you're along for the ride. And for some of us, that means that our hearts cry out for you in deep anguish. And we need you so deeply and desperately. During this holy season of Lent, help us to know that we can come as we are, exactly as we are, from wherever we have been to this place, and know that you will receive us with grace, with mercy, with forgiveness, with compassion and love. We know that you will set your seal upon our hearts and you will lead us to the place that you want us to be. Holy God, we ask you, And we thank you that you take us as we are. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
If you're able, will you please stand as I read the New Testament reading for today? It's taken from the book of Matthew, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. The word of God for the people of God. Please be seated.
Now you can sit. Sorry. Thought you needed a little exercise this morning. Will you pray with me? Holy God, send your spirit upon us that as your scripture has been read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what it is you have to say to us this day. Amen. So when I was little, I don't know, it must have been before kindergarten or maybe I was in kindergarten because I just remember being with my mother alone. So I think that my sister, who is older, she must have been in school. So I was either pre-K or kindergarten where I only went half a day. But anyway, I remember this one particular instance where we went to a store, TGY. Did anybody ever have a TGY? Anybody? My aunt used to say that stood for terrible, gross, and yucky. I don't know. But so anyway, we were at TGY. I remember it very specifically. And we walked in, and I just remember that the floors were so shiny. They were so shiny because I could see the light from above shined into those floors, right, on the tiles. And I remember that if you kind of followed the light on the floor, that it would kind of move, but not as fast as you moved. Of course, I didn't know, like, I don't even know what, is it physics? I don't even know, but you know how if this, like, shines here, like, it's going to move a little bit from my perspective, right? But when I get right here, I'm going to be right on it, right? So anyway, I didn't know that, but I just thought the light was moving, and I thought that was amazing, and when I got right on it, I could jump over it, right? And then there was another one, because there were lights all the way down the aisle. So then I was going to another one, and it was just so funny, because it, like, looked like it moved. And then you get there and jump over that one too, right? And I just kept doing that all the way down the aisle, maybe around a corner, I don't remember, until I looked up and realized I had gotten myself good and lost. I had no idea where I was. I remember that in TGY, I just have this really vague memory of this dingy store with shiny floors, right? And that there were these big, like, bolts of, like, fabric. I don't know. I remember being in those and thinking, where am I? What in the world? You know, there was no big scene. There was no big announcement over the PA system or anything like that because my mom, she knew where I was the whole time. You know, she was just kind of following along, looking at merchandise. She'd be over here looking. She'd kind of look over. She could see me, right? She just kind of moved along with me. And so even though she was kind of in the merchandise and I was in the aisle, she knew where I was the whole time. But I, here, was completely lost. No idea. No idea. So here we are in the season of Lent. On Wednesday, we celebrated Ash Wednesday. So for those of you who were here, you know that we observed that service by really entering into the season of Lent as a time of repentance, as a time of recognizing that we are frail as people and we make mistakes and we are in need of God's grace. We're in need of forgiveness. We are in need of so many things. And that was a good time of remembering that and also feeling the freedom that God gives us in that forgiveness. So welcome to Lent. 40 days between Ash Wednesday and Easter, not counting Sundays, because those are little Easters or little celebrations of the resurrection. For some of us, we need extra prayers because there's a small group of us that are doing a Bible study called A Place at the Table. And for 40 days, we are fasting in different kinds of ways. So not a full-out fast where we don't eat anything, but where we might have chosen certain patterns of a diet or whatever to adhere to. In the Dillon house, there's a lot of beans and rice. So when they were talking up here at the kids' time about what foods do you like, and Emery was just thinking about all of them, he's already had a few meals of beans and rice, and he's thinking, oh, there's so many foods that I love. Because you start thinking about that when all you're eating is beans and rice. So, and we're only a few days in, so lots of prayers. So welcome to Lent. During this season, we're going to be looking at not just the stories of Jesus and his kind of path as he walks along to the road to Easter, but for this particular Lent, we're also going to weave in the stories of Exodus, the stories of the people of Israel, where they were, as Hebrews, slaves in Egypt. And then you know the story. Moses came, there were plagues and stuff, and then Pharaoh let the people go. And they were so excited to be let go, and then what happened? They got lost. They got lost. And they wandered in the desert or in the wilderness for 40 years. 40 years. There's some kind of natural connection between the stories of Exodus and the wandering people and the stories of Jesus, especially his 40 days of fasting and temptation in the wilderness. We'll talk about some of those stories as we go along. Today we hear a very, very ancient piece of poetry in the Exodus passage. So Fred read for us that after they had crossed the Red Sea, right? You remember the story, I don't have to go over it, do I, right? So they had crossed the Red Sea, the Hebrews, the Israelites, they had gotten across, and the Egyptians that were following them, they were drowned in the Red Sea, right, as it kind of came back. And then we have this story, actually right before Miriam sings her song, Moses has this great long speech, blah, 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 blah. And it goes on and on and on for many, many verses. And then Miriam, his sister, gets out with all of the women and sings and dances. And some scholars believe that that little snippet of poetry that, you know, great is God, he threw the horse and the rider into the sea, is like one of the most ancient pieces of poetry that we have from that time, that actually that probably originated very close to the actual time of this happening. So it's a very ancient piece. I love that Miriam is the one that is singing and dancing and being a leader of the women. And I have so enjoyed reading and studying about her this week. So I want to tell you four kind of special times. You may know these times, but that are important times throughout this story of the Israelites in which Miriam is a main character, right? Of course, the first one we all know, right? The story of baby Moses, where they were the Hebrews and the Egyptians were getting really kind of scared that the Hebrews were having so many babies and multiplying so much because the Hebrews were supposed to be their slaves, right? And they kind of thought, goodness, just by sheer numbers, these people could overtake us because they're getting to be so large, right? And so the Pharaoh decided, okay, so all the firstborn babies must be killed. All of the firstborn babies of the Hebrews must be killed. And so Moses' mother had Moses, and he looked to be so strong and healthy and beautiful, she just could not do it. And so she put together a little basket, right, with something on the outside to make it waterproof, whatever, and put the baby in it. And Miriam was there, his sister, put it in the Nile. She said, Miriam, go. Watch where the baby goes. Watch and see, right? And so Miriam, this young girl, we guess, at the time, I don't know, is following along and watching the baby and watching over him, making sure that nothing happens. The Pharaoh's daughter finds this baby and thinks he's so beautiful and wants to keep him and says, please, Daddy, please, can I keep the baby? And he says, sure, whatever, right? But she's not a mama. And so she's like, well, I've got to have somebody to nurse this baby. And who's right there? Miriam, right? Hey, I happen to know someone who could be a nursemaid just for that baby, right? And she's the one, Miriam, that is the guardian of baby Moses so that he doesn't fall into peril, but makes sure he gets to a safe place and cares for him. And the second time we really see Miriam come out as a character is this story. As they've just crossed the Red Sea and they're safe and it's a celebration. And Miriam, she's kind of the official or unofficial, I'm not sure, leader of all of the women of these people. And she gets out with all of the women and they start to dance. And imagine what it would be like if you had been a slave your whole life and your very bones and muscles had groaned for years, your whole life. Oh, I just want to be free. I just want to be free. And finally, they are free and they sing and they dance. And Miriam is their leader. So there are three siblings, according to which kind of version you read in our scriptures. Sometimes Aaron is present, sometimes Aaron is not. So there's Moses and his brother Aaron and his sister Miriam, right? So they're important, Aaron and Miriam. They're important kind of second people, second in command, maybe, sort of, to Moses. So he kind of relies on them in different ways. But there's this one scene when we get further along in the story that Miriam disagrees with Moses around marrying this lady and da-da-da-da-da. And so apparently Miriam says something that's not very nice. And God punishes her by giving her leprosy. So if you have ever gossiped or said something really bad about somebody, I want you to remember the story of Miriam. God is like, you shall not, you know, and then they talk about the white Miriam, like her skin turned white. I don't know if it was because it was so flaky. I don't know. We could go into details that probably aren't worth, like, thinking about too much as to why she was so, like, white, why they called her white, but she was, like, had this terrible, terrible skin thing going on. And Moses finally, like, said a few words in prayer, and she was healed. But there was that moment, those moments, where Miriam kind of went off the path a little bit, right? And got smote. I don't even know if that's a word, but smited. I don't know. God did something to her, right? Wasn't very good. And then the last story, or the last real segment of Miriam's life that we hear in the scriptures, is when she dies. She has been a faithful follower of Moses her whole life. She has guided him when he was just a baby to make sure that he was safe. And the whole 40 years, or whatever that really means, that the Israelites wandered in the wilderness, she was there beside Moses, trying to find it too, the promised land, searching, searching, traveling, being a companion along the way. And they're out in the wilderness, and it's dry. And she dies, and they lay her to rest. And in honor of who she is, because of all that she has done, God creates a spring to gush forward from that place, that it would become a place of water, a place that would give life. So those are our stories of Miriam. I think it's pretty interesting that throughout the stories of Miriam, there really is that water imagery that kind of pulls it through. Maybe not necessarily in the leprosy one. And I don't know why I told you that one. I just thought it was funny. Except when I say something bad about somebody, I don't think it's funny. But the water, right, that Miriam saved Moses through the water. Miriam celebrated with the people after they'd crossed the Red Sea. And then this beautiful, beautiful story of her dying and being buried and water gushing to life out of that spot. And then we hear the story of John the Baptist. So, pause, right? Fast forward. Right, all the way over here. And we've got John the Baptist. And what is he foretelling? He's foretelling that Jesus is going to be coming. He's saying, you know, get ready. There's somebody coming. And what is this person going to do? This person is going to baptize you with water, but also with the Holy Spirit. And so that water imagery kind of runs through. There's a big space, isn't there? Between the deliverance of God and God's people out of Egypt, and then this place where John the Baptist is saying, somebody's coming to show you the way, right? Because what happened between the celebration, yay, God is so great, God got us out of there, and be ready, somebody's coming? The people got lost, didn't they? And I would kind of venture a guess that sometimes they were lost and found and lost and found and lost and found. But as a people, they were lost. Think of what it would have been like on the shores of the Red Sea. You had just been delivered from your slavery. From generations and generations, you are free as a people. And you're singing these praises and dancing them and living them. And it's a great celebration. But we are so fickle as people, aren't we? We humans, we are quick to forget. And it's not too much later that the Israelites start to moan. And they start to groan. And they start to think how great it was back in Egypt. And they are unhappy that they haven't made it to the promised land. And then generations and generations and generations later, they need a new way. They need a new path because they've been lost. I love this poem. You know that Anne Weems is one of my favorite poets. And I don't know if this story of Miriam and the song that she sings is kind of the basis of this poem. I don't know, but at least in this Alive Now magazine that I have, I know this is a picture. You probably can't see it. It's like watermarked. It's a picture of Miriam behind it, kind of dancing. So I always think that it's about her. I don't know if it really is. Good news music. I've read this to you before, but listen. How long will we come before the Lord with tired spirits and droning voices? How long will we sit in half-filled churches and sing praise with noiseless songs? How long will we worship with bored faces and dulled senses and offer tin when we could give gold? Do we or do we not believe the news is good? Oh Lord, you love us. Why aren't we shouting? We don't have to earn it. Why aren't we singing? The stones rolled away. Why aren't we dancing to your good news music? Oh Lord, you love us. Why aren't the bells pealing? The victory's won. Why aren't the drums beating? And you forgave us. Why aren't the harps resounding to your good news music? Why aren't the feet stomping and the doves flying and the bands marching and the fingers snapping and the tongues praising and the hands clapping and the trumpets blaring and the choir singing and the cymbals clashing and the children laughing? And why aren't the people coming to bow down? Why aren't the eyes smiling and the knees kneeling and the banners blowing and the horns sounding and the voices calling and the crowds clamoring and the arms waving and the tambourines playing and the hearts humming and the old men running? And why aren't we crowning Christ Lord of Lords? If the news is good, sing. Sing. Miriam sang. She sang here and she danced and all of the women with her. And then somewhere along the way, the people got tired. The people aged. The people grieved and suffered. The people lost their way. And so then John the Baptist had to come and say, get ready. Because there's somebody's coming. And that somebody is going to show you the way. It may seem like an oxymoron or a paradox to think that we actually need to get a little lost before we can get found. I was thinking of this time when I was in Loveland. I was on staff at Loveland, First United Methodist Church, years ago. And I was part of our pastoral care team, and they gave me just kind of a name of somebody. Go contact this lady and see if she wants you to bring communion. Okay? It's like, okay. I did not know who this person was. She was an elderly lady, which really doesn't have much to do with it, except that when I called her and to reach out to her, because she was, I guess, not coming to church or whatever, and asked her if I could bring her communion, she said, oh, no, 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 no. I'm done with that. I used to go to church. I did all that. I was on committees. I was involved in things, but that part's done now. I don't need you to come here. And it just made me think, wow. Well, actually, I was like, oh, what do I do, you know? I had no idea what to do. And I'm sure I stumbled my way through it and hung up the phone and was like, oh my gosh, probably totally ruined everything there. But the whole sense that I got from her was, that was then, I'm done, did it. The God thing, done, right? I have no doubt that somewhere along her journey she had sung, she had danced. But somewhere along the way she got lost. And thought that the only connection with church was attending meetings or being able to attend worship or whatever, be present. And didn't know that we could still connect in that way. Of course, it's not just elderly people who are home. I've had very, very similar conversations with younger people who maybe grew up in church, but I did that, right? I'm done with that. Because somewhere along the way, they became tired, or they became hurt, or they suffered. Somehow they lost their way. And the good news in our wilderness wandering is that even when we feel lost, God knows where we are. God knows. And as we hear the John the Baptist say, someone is coming that will show us the way. I pray these have been the words of the Lord for us this day. Amen. I invite you to stand and join with us in our closing hymn. We'll be singing that all of Lent, so you'll get a chance to learn that song and sing it with us. As you're standing, I invite you to reach out your hand to those around you. Don't let anybody stand alone, but let us be connected. Let us be the body of Christ in this place. And as you go from this place, may the love of God, the grace and peace of Jesus the Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love, now and forever. Amen.